Hey guys, good afternoon. Not the number of people that we were expecting, but hey. So our topic is reducing the effect of turbidity in underwater images. And I am Pranoy Goswami, and I am a software engineer at McKinsey & Company based out of India. And he's my colleague, my friend Himanshu. He's based out of, can you introduce yourself?
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Manjit. I'm based out of Bangalore and I'm currently working in Cube Club.
Thank you. We'll just get started. Two more folks. So we are just catching up. So yeah, so the topic is reducing the effect of turbidity in underwater images. We can move to the next slide. So yes, a picture is a poem without words. So it has been very rightly said by Forrest that a picture is a poem without words. Like pictures are a way in which visual information is expressed in a very particular way, in a better way than words. So that's why a picture is a poem without words. The amount of information that can be extracted from pictures is immense. That's why the field of computer vision is growing these days at such large pace. Be it image enhancements, image recognition, feature extractions, visual question and answer. So yes, a picture is going without words. So need for underwater imagery. So why is underwater imagery needed at all? So the first point is monitoring marine benthic habitats such as coral reefs, kelp forests. So, underwater imagery is used in such applications. Classifying and counting the number of aquatic species present in a particular ecosystem. Then, in marine archaeology, to analyze seabeds and shipwrecks. Also, in surveillance activities, which is actually the application of computer vision and underwater imagery these days, which is being very widely used using autonomous underwater vehicles and robot operating vehicles. So these are applications in armed forces as well as especially in the exploration of underwater gas reservoirs and also more for monitoring the underwater gas pipelines. And move on to the next slide. So yes, so our problem statement targets the marine archaeologists. So we are trying to solve their problem to actually analyze the features present in underwater images. So this is one of the raw images from the dataset, and we will run our algorithm on this and figure out the features present. At this point of time, insight to it. So at this point of time, the stone that you can see, which is the artifact, that this looks very the surface looks very smooth, like the texture is pretty smooth, but it's actually not that. I see a lot of people joining us, so it's fine. So we can move to the next slide. So how is underwater imagery different from imagery on land? So as we all know that every medium has a refractive index, right? So water has a refractive index, and due to that, scattering of light happens. Also, when particulate matter and turbidity is there, scattering happens, which actually leads to a Tyndall effect. Then wavelength absorption causes color reduction, and artificial lighting, like sometimes to cater the problem of underwater imagery, artificial lighting is used, like green lights and blue lights are mostly used to tackle this issue, but that sometimes causes vignetting. So anyone has an idea what vignetting is? Anyone? I think you all must have used it. So in your Instagram applications, there's a filter called vignetting. So when there is darkening in the edges of the image and the center is actually focused out, that's what vignetting is. So artificial lighting causes vignetting, which leads to loss of features for marine archaeologists. So I would reiterate here that this solution, this algorithm that we have developed and the product that we are trying to materialize now targets more on feature extraction rather than beautification. So if you classify a computer vision problem, mostly it's like we fall into the feature extraction part. So that's what, can we move to the next slide? this is the actual problem statement. It's clearly mentioned this solution aims to reduce the effect of turbidity from underwater images for marine archaeologists. This research took place at National Institute of Oceanography, India, and it started in late 2014. In the month of December, we started working on it. Then the data set that we have covered here is actually obtained from the underwater explorations done along the western coast of India, especially near the Swarashtra coast, that's Dwarka. So the artifacts obtained, the data set obtained is from there, and especially near the coastal area, that's just near the coastal area, the amount of silt, the amount of turbidity and the amount of silt is very high, and that's what causes loss in features in the images. So this is an algorithm that we have designed for the image, for our underwater to reduce the effect of turbidity from images. So there's an input image. The input image is usually an RGB image. That's red. That's a color space. Then we convert the image into the YCbCr color space. Then we perform CLAHE. So CLAHE, we get on to each one of the steps in detail. So CLAHE is contrast limited adaptive histogram equalization. Then we convert the image back to the RGB color space because we want to make it coherent to the original image. Then we apply a bilateral filter on the image, and then we wavelet denoising, and that's the output image, right? So the thing that we are going to present now is actually a POC. So we can deep dive into the approach. So step one, convert the image into YCrCb color space. Why YCrCb color space? Like, there are a lot of color spaces. Why only YCrCb color space? The first reason for this is that the YCrCb is a very storage efficient model. The GPU that we were using during the image processing was NVIDIA CUDA GT557. So YCrCb color space is actually very color efficient because the CBCR are actually the chroma components, which is actually a plane. So it's a planar, region. Which contains the chroma components, and Y component is actually only the luma component. The luma component is actually the luminescence value. It's one of the most fundamental, it's among the most fundamental units of measurement. So it's the luminescence value. And for specifically for histogram equalization, we are only concerned with the luminescence value. That's the Y channel of the YCrCb color space. So that's why we converted it into the YCrCb color space. The other reason is that due to the increasing depth, non-uniform light distribution occurs. So that's why we needed the luminescence channel to do preprocessing on the image. So that's why we've converted the image into the YCrCb color space. And we'll come to the next step, please. So this is the step. So there's the input RGB image. This is just a sample, the source is PG1. There's input RGB image which is split into RGB things. Then the RGB is actually shown into the YCrCb color space. So here you can see the YCrCb color space is actually just the black and white, or you can say the grayscale image, which only contains the luminescence factor. That's it, nothing else. So yeah, can move to the next slide. So the second step is perform CLAHE on the converted image. So yes, what is CLAHE? CLAHE is contrast limited adaptive histogram equalization. Why do we do it? Like, why not normal histogram equalization or even adaptive histogram equalization? So the thing is that when we do histogram equalization, every image has a signal to noise ratio, right, which is called an SNR. So in adaptive histogram equalization, when we do enhancement, the over-amplification of noise also occurs. But we don't want noise. We want a high SNR and a low noise signal ratio. Right? We want a low noise in the image because we want to. Our primary goal is to extract the artifacts from the images. So that's why contrast limited adaptive histogram equalization. And also, if you want to explore into the detail of this algorithm and an approach, we are actually in the process of creating a GitHub. Wiki and a resource for the whole for our whole algorithm, so we can discuss that. Can we move to the next slide? Yeah, so this is the original image. You can see that the contours of the first image are actually skewed. They are concentrated at a particular region in this image. And also the contrast changes, the changes in the contrast are not visible. The features are actually, some of the features that are very far away are actually, we are not able to see them very clearly. But after performing the CLAHE on that image, the features are very clearly visible. So, and also this noise, the amount of noise added into the image is not that much. And but if we apply normal histogram equalization, the noise is also amplified. So that's why CLAHE is used.
So yes, I will now give the mic to Marsha.
Moving on to the step 3, so currently what we have is an event in YCbCr. So we have converted back to the RGBCr. So it is required because to make the process change coherently originally. So as you can see, on the left hand side we have ICRC converted to RGBCr, on the right hand side we converted to RGBCr. So after that,
looks like we can talk about it. I'm sorry. Yeah, please go ahead.
So as you can see in this image, so on the left hand side we have the original image. So you can see in the water there are a lot of wavelets in white color dots, you can see. So on the right hand side we have the smooth band image after applying the bilateral filter. So there is a lot of difference in both images, as you can see clearly. Move on to the next slide. So yeah. So our last step is wavelet denoising. So, what we're doing this is reconstructing a signal from a noisy one. So, as we have a RGB color space image, and now what the main idea is to have the amplitude rather than the location of the spectrum to be as out of phase as that of the noise. So, it mainly allows shrinking of the amplitude to transform and reduce the noise. Yeah.
So, we aim in wavelet denoising. We actually aim for a destructive superimposition. If you have read about wave theory, so we try to have a destructive superimposition of the image and the noise signals, so that the noise signal and the original actual meaningful signal are out of phase. So we try to have a destructive superimposition. So this is the example. Please go.
So on the left hand side is the noisy image. So after applying the wavelet denoising filter, you can see that the noise is reduced in the right hand side.
And also the SNR, eventually the SNR, signal to noise ratio is increased in the second image. This is the original image which we showed you in the beginning. So this looks, the features in this image, basically the texture of the rock specifically looks very clear, but is it actually this way? So let's find out. Can we move to the next slide? So this is a grayscale image, that's actually the Y component of the YCRTV color space. So we have extracted the Y luminescence component in the image. Yes, so this is actually the feature. So the rock actually looks like this. This is the amount of texture, the nature of the the texture of the rock, which it actually is, but because of light refractions due to scattering, we were able to see a very smooth image. So, so one might wonder why it is so important that these features, that these textures are, why is it so important for marine archaeologists? So we all have heard about weathering of rocks, I think, in our geography courses in primary school. So weathering of rocks is actually the phenomenon by which basically marine archaeologists determine the age of the rocks. So here, with the texture, the actual amount of weathering is actually determined. The amount, the age of the rocks, nature of in which the rocks have been kept. So yeah, so that's it. That's why feature basically these textures are necessary for marine archaeologists to mine. Then yes, can we move to the next slide? So yes, this is the final image after bilateral smoothing and wavelet denoising. So this is actually the feature, and can we have another slide in which we have, yeah, this is the comparison of the original image and the final image. So you can see a stark difference between the original image and the final image. Actually the texture is that, but we see that. So these images have been taken using a Guppy F80 underwater cam sensor. So yeah, can we move ahead? Yes, so lots and lots we have spoken about that algorithm, but what's the impact? Like, how can we, sell this product, or how is it beneficial? How has it simplified life? Because in the end, if we are doing programming, AI or even computer programming, if we're not solving problems, I don't think we are creating that any impact. It should make our life simpler. So what's the impact? Yeah. Yes, so this solution was integrated in the AUVs and ROVs present at the research facility at NIO Goa. And it automated the underwater explorations using the AUVs and ROVs. So what we did was, NIO hosted their own servers. So we deployed this algorithm into the NIO servers and their AUVs and ROVs. So I'll just give you my personal experience of what I saw when I went into the underwater exploration in the year 2015 with the team. So the ferry contained two specialist divers, deep sea divers, that would take photographs of the artifacts, and four other NIO folks, of which one was a field guide, a couple of scientists. But at this point of time, they only carry one AUV, one medium skilled diver, and a scientist, a marine archaeologist. So the number of man hours that we have saved is actually 3 for every underwater exploration that they took. And this exploration happened every fortnight. Most of the time they went for, at least once in a month they went for an exploration. So this is the impact that we have created. The next, can we move to the next slide? So yes, at least 10,000 man hours saved in a year at NIO Goa alone. So at this point, so yeah, this is huge. Yes. They are now trying to integrate this feature into NIOT Chennai, India, which is like NIO Goa is based on the western coast of Indian Peninsula, and NIOT Chennai is based out of the eastern coast. So they are trying to integrate this. We are trying to integrate this solution in this algorithm into their AUVs and ROVs also this time. So yeah, that's, aren't you proud? So yeah, we'll move to the next slide. Yeah, these are the references, and that's it. There's one thing that we wanted to share. So what's next? I think we missed that slide. So what's next? So at this point of time, due to the ubiquitous nature of our smartphone cameras, so what Himanshu and I are trying to do is that we are trying to develop an application that actually we are developing it in React Native. We have not made the code live yet and also public yet. It's still a work in progress. We are planning to launch it by the end of April. So we are planning to develop an application which actually will be integrated into our smartphones, and we will be able to filter out, like we are adding some more features into it. When we launch it, let's have a look. I guess you guys should have a look. So, that's it. I think Himanshu can elaborate more on the tech stack about the application, what we are trying to develop. So, please.
Yeah. So, regarding the application, so what we are trying to develop is that we are making an iterative application in which we will make it as a simplistic, minimalistic UI in which a user can directly click an image in the underwater and upload it into our servers, and then he can select all the images which he wants to process, and then final images will be processed and send it as an email to that user. So it will be a very handy application related to the image processing. So this we want to.
There's also one use case that we see in most parts of, like, I'm talking about the Indian geography at this point of time because I'm not, because we are focusing on that. So in the northern parts of India, in the month of, in the winter months, there is a lot of fog, smog as well as smog, and haze is also there. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to integrate this solution with LIDAR as well, so that during foggy environments also we can have an application which works and tell us about the obstructions in front of us using live frame capturing and video capturing. So this is still a work in progress. We are planning to roll out by end of April 2018 if everything goes according to plan. So we are at a lot of glitches in between, but I hope things will pan out as planned. So that's it, guys. I think that we can move to the next slide. So who we are, find us at. So yeah, any questions? Last slide. So yeah, any questions? Any questions, anybody? Cool. I think we're good. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Oh, there's a question. Oh, finally, there are a question.
Please. Is this kind of solution can be used into we all know UAV, so it can be used under the water also. But if I want to use that into the UAV system, maybe have to. Okay. Can you?
It can cater the need of unmanned aerial systems. I think that's what you're talking about. Unmanned aerial vehicles. So it can cater the need to that. But in the algorithm, the last step was wavelet denoising, right? Wavelet denoising is mostly applied into underwater images. Like, because if this algorithm can be used for UAVs, that's the answer to your question. But there needs to be some modification to that. Because if the medium changes, so I think that's a good suggestion we can keep that in mind. So if the medium changes, what algorithm rather we should apply? So I think in aerial images, wavelet denoising will be an overkill. Because wavelet denoising actually requires a lot of GPU processing, and that will be an overkill. Only with the bilateral filter we can achieve your use case. So I hope I answered your question.
Another question.
Yeah, sure.
We are doing some lab CubeSat, basic CubeSat. We want to doing some monitor for the Earth to adjust our direction or the situation for the CubeSat. So we need a very smart monitor. You know, your system can adjust the bird, right?
Absolutely, I did not get you properly. So this is a monitor. What are you trying to develop? I'm sorry, I did not get the...
Okay. Because my camera will watch the Earth.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because the reject the light,
okay,
will be any other ways or any other direction.
Okay.
To make our system very boring.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So maybe this kind of system maybe can be visible to our camera.
Yeah, it can be integrated to if you're looking in if you're looking for feature extraction specifically. I think you said that you're doing a monitoring, right? So you want clear features. So this can be integrated. So we have tried these images using a Guppy F80. So if there's a better sensor, I think this algorithm will function. Better sensor as well as better GPUs. Like the GPU that we use was not that great. NVIDIA CUDA, the CUDA GT570 is not that great. It was 4GB GPU, so it was not that great. So I think if provided the required amount of technical technical diet, that's the term. So I think this algorithm will work fine.
Alright.
Yeah.
But using the GPU just means the power consumption will be more and more.
If you are trying to capture more features, like I get that. Like if you want to do monitoring from a very high level altitude, then you need to have good sensors, right? That's one point. So that you cannot deny. So if you have good sensors, the size of the images will be larger. So it will require more. It's all directly proportional, right? Larger images, more processing power, more computational costs. So that's one. So but this algorithm. With some modifications, I'm not saying, I'm not 100% sure, but with some modifications, we'll be able to cater that need. And that's what we are trying to also do, like in foggy and hazy situations, that will be an area limit, right? So that's what we are also trying to achieve.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, everyone. Yeah, okay. Another question.
Yes, I'm just wondering, I think there are several other marine institutes in the world that are probably, or that have probably also like encountered this issue with images turbidity and stuff. So do you know how they approach the problem, or is there any solve it?
Yeah, so when the research started, we did a feasibility study. So we figured out that there are a lot of codes, like some proprietary tools that do that. There's a tool called Automano Giga. So another thing that we are trying to achieve is now create image mosaics, right? So image mosaic is actually the stitched image. It's a 3D projection. Like if you have seen Titanic, if I create an image mosaic of the sunken ship, so it will look like a 3D projection of the Titanic, right? If you have seen Iron Man movies, those are all mostly image mosaics. Although those are projections, but image mosaic is more of, it will more have the real sense. It will not be only single color. So there is a tool called Autopano Giga developed by MIT folks that actually does that. So, but it's a costly tool. But we are trying to open source it, that's why we are in FOSS. So yeah, to answer your question, yes, there are tools that help do it. There are proprietary tools that help in these situations. But what's our USP is that, first of all, we are free. At this point in time, we are open source. The second thing is that the stack that we have used is very minimalistic. We are using OpenCV with C++. We are planning to move to Python as well. Because we are not able to scale at this point of time. So yeah, so that's what I think the best USP is that we are open source, we are free, and if that's what everyone needs. And we have had a success story that I'll show you. This solution has already been this solution has already been used by National Institute of Oceanography in India. So now they have automated their underwater explorations. So this is already in. It's live. This solution is already live. So yeah, thanks a lot. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.